Good evening, everyone. Thank you to Alchem for this Legend in Medicine series. This webinar is the third in the series. I know that all of you are waiting to dissect another legend, and I'm sure you'll not be disappointed. I'm Dr. Ratna Maheshwari, and I'm indeed honored to be able to sit across a giant today and analyze all the qualities that make him legendary. Dr. Ashok N. Johri is regarded as the father of pediatric orthopedics in India. He's been the past professor of orthopedic surgery at the Mumbai University and is currently the director of pediatric orthopedics at Nanavati Hospital. He spearheaded the pediatric movement in India and the development of the specialty. He pioneered the introduction of many innovations and procedures in India. Magnetic lengthening of limbs, growth rods for the spine, multi-segmental instrumentation for spine, endoscopic anterior spine surgery, vector, botulinum toxin, etc. He's one of the few Indians and probably the first to be the editor of an international peer-reviewed journal, which is the Journal of Pediatric Orthopedics B since 2006. He has been the president of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India in 2005, the Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy in 2008, Indian Orthopedic Association in 2010, Asia Pacific Knee Society in 2012, SICOT World Congress in 2013, President of the Asia Pacific Pediatric Orthopedic Society in 2017, and the World Association Against Infections in Orthopedics and Trauma in 2019. He is the President-elect of the World Body of Orthopedics, SICOT, and will be the President from 2020 to 2022. Awards, prizes, national and international recognition have come galore as a tribute to his hard work and vision. This is where it all began. Mumbai, February 1955. He seems to have a wise look even then. And the first time I saw this picture, I remember wondering what those bright eyes were envisioning possibly even at that age. Here is a fun fact about Dr. Johri that many of you probably do not know. He was a trained and licensed pilot, and I often joke that he operates in an orbit of his own. His life has been a call to produce work that woes and live days that inspire. Many of his patients regard him as God incarnate, and it's easy to understand why. He is a creative genius when it comes to the art of medicine, whether in the outpatient or the operating room. The operating room is his canvas, patience and perfection in each stroke. From the way he handles the tissue planes to the dissection or to the subcuticular closure. People who have worked under him, fortunately or unfortunately, will recall that he won't hesitate to redo a case if he's unsatisfied with the surgery, even if it's 3 a.m. at night, and then reach his Mahim OPD the same morning, ever smiling, ever patient, to answer every query a worried mother may have. Children under his care adore him for being so gentle. He's trained in India and in many, many countries abroad, receiving accolades, medals, and prizes. He was always regarded as an ideal student by his teachers. He is the man who started it all, the Pediatric Orthopedic Society in India, along with Professor Benjamin Joseph. And it's now a vibrant society which recently completed its 25th year in 2019. His life work has inspired generations of orthopedic surgeons to train into the pediatric specialty. His students adore him deeply. In spite of his busy schedule, there is always time for philanthropy. Numerous free Botox and legendary surgical camps have been conducted under his leadership. He has also supported educational funds and academic learning by organizing conclaves under the Child Care Foundation. But behind that serious persona is a very, very fun person. And one can often see that aspect of his personality come alive in conference banquets, where he's requested to sing often. In spite of all his achievements, his humility and graciousness are his most endearing qualities. If few lines could summarize his life philosophy, I would quote these lines from the Gita for him. See the flower, how generously it distributes perfume and honey. And when its work is done, it falls away quietly. Try to be like the flower, unassuming despite all its qualities. That I happen to be his daughter makes this discussion really special for me. I'm sharing this conversation between my father and me, much like that between Krishna and Arjun in Mahabharata, to dig deeper into the problems of life. And I'm sure we'll all get solutions to the dilemmas facing us. Let us listen to what a few of his colleagues and previous fellows have to say about him.
His contribution to Pedantic Orthopedics is not only known nationally but internationally. He's an excellent surgeon, great academician, a good human being, and a very kind and a good doctor.
The one thing that has really impressed me is his passion for perfection.
If I have to define mentor and mentorship in one word, it's Dr. Ashok Johari.
And he has taught all of us, you know, that you have to work hard, you have to work sincerely.
He's a hardcore academician who has brought pediatric orthopedics to the forefront. Truly a pioneer of this specialty in India.
And I have seen his results, which are very amazing in the field of pediatric orthopedics.
He says that my usual sleep is around 4 to 5 hours. So I tell him that if you sleep 7 hours, your brain will be like an Einstein.
His contribution to Indian Orthopedic Society by innovation and introduction of many new technologies.
His energy and stamina for practice is phenomenal. I have not seen any orthopedic surgeon having such a dedication for the practice.
He's a pioneer of pediatric orthopedic surgery in India.
Apart from being a great human being, he's also a great teacher.
He taught us how to be compassionate towards the subject and also towards his patients.
He's a pioneer and innovator in the field of pediatric and a spine surgeon.
His tremendous work and research in spinal deformities and cerebral palsy has helped many young orthopedic surgeons.
And he's a great teacher, he's a great surgeon, and he's a wonderful person.
He is a very good orthopedic surgeon as well as he's a very good orthopedic teacher.
Professor Ashok Johari is a living legend. He is an inspiration to all of us. He is an institution in himself.
He is a pioneer of pediatric orthopedic surgery in India.
Dr. Ashok Johari is not only a prolific pediatric orthopedic surgeon, I would call him the father of pediatric orthopedics in the country, and is responsible for making pediatric orthopedics a financially viable and glamorous subspecialty in our country.
Pediatric orthopedics got its fame and its identity in India because of his untiring words, untiring efforts, and unconditional devotion for the betterment of this branch.
So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
So I want to start by asking you, what makes a person a legend? What qualities or attributes? Why is it worth discussing someone? Is it your qualification, your awards? Is it your academic background? Is it your contribution to the subject or to the society? What is it, sir?
Okay, Ratna, this is the holy month of Ramzan. And let me start by saying Ramadan Mubarak to all my friends, Muslim friends, not only in India, but all over the world, the Arabian countries, Iran, Iraq, and everywhere. I think they're watching this program. So Ramadan Mubarak, and as they say, Bismillah, Hir Rahman, Nir Rahim. So to answer your question, you know, the first question was about legend. What makes a person a legend? Well, it's very simple, actually. Just look around you. Whomever you call a legend, whether it was Mahatma Gandhi, Swami Vivekananda, or any other legend, a sports legend or a film star legend, you know. He has always contributed. He's made a significant impact in the lives of people, whether it is by an academic contribution, whether by elevation of the status of science, adding new knowledge, whether changing people's thoughts, whether changing people's value systems, or whether it is the welfare of society. You know. So they have contributed. A legend is one who's always given something. You know, he has given of his special talents to society, to people, you know, for upliftment. He's contributed immensely to the world in different ways. And that is why he's a legend, you know. So nobody just becomes a legend by receiving, you know. It's important thing about a legend, you know. You don't become a legend because you receive something. You receive an award or whatever, you receive a degree, you know, that doesn't make you a legend. It is by contributing, by giving, that you become a legend. You know, academic qualifications, background, nothing really matters in this situation. You know? So it's a capacity to give, your capacity to significantly impact the life of others, or to change the course of practice, change the science, advance the science, or take the country to a higher level. You know, all this will make you legend depending on your status, a local legend, a national legend, an international legend.
Okay, so it's rare to find people who stand out so much in all aspects. Please tell us a bit about what has shaped you. Tell us about your childhood and early influences.
Yes, actually, much of my shaping or molding started from childhood. And I'm grateful to my parents for that. We came from very lowly means, though from a Jagirdar family, and that Jagir is still existing in Bikaner in Rajasthan. You know, something happened and the family wealth dwindled. We were jewelers to princes in the north of India, in the south of India, but I really don't know what led to the dwindling of family fortunes. And my dad came to Mumbai for a medical education. And because he was not supported by anyone, you know, the means were very, very little. It was very, very difficult time, you know. And I remember spending my childhood in something a little better than a slum, you know, where a lot of people were around me, you know. And I really want to say, you know, that living in such a deprived situation actually contributed a lot to my molding, you know, because I was always surrounded by people, most of whom you would say are bad people or dangerous people. So I learned how to get along with dangerous people, how to get along with bad people, how to be firmly rooted in the ground. I also learned why people remain poor, why do they remain unfortunate, you know. So all these were early lessons in my life, you know. So being rooted to the ground, being able to think on your feet, I think actually my early part of my living gave me all that, you know. Now, my dad was a doctor. He was an anesthetist, but he was struggling to settle himself. And my memories of him, you know, because he really taught me and shaped me a lot. You know, he was a strict disciplinarian. And always, every now and then, he would be teaching me, you know. So what he taught me, that was also very, very important. You know, he taught me to think. He taught me the why of everything, you know. Rudyard Kipling had 6 servants, as you know, why, when, what, how, and all that, which, you know. So he was always asking me questions like, why do you think this way? Why do you want to say this? Why do you not think, why don't you take that other choice, you know? So from a very young age, I learned how to reason out. The other thing he taught me is that it's important to think correctly. So you sow a thought and you reap an act, action actually. You reap an act and you make a habit, you know. You reap a habit, you make a character. You make a character and that determines your destiny. So these are important things I learned from him, you know. Now also important was the fact that he was a disciplinarian. So my first important lesson in life was discipline. My life is based on 4 D's, which I will sort of enlighten people today. But the first D was discipline. I learned that very early in life. I had to be with him on school holidays. Thursday was a school holiday, which meant that I would go along with him for surgery from a young age of 5 years. I used to accompany him, stand in the operation theater on a high stool and watch what was going on. Stand there the whole day seeing surgeries, you know, and he didn't want me to waste time. You know, he knew that if I wasted time in the chawl on a Thursday, you know, I would probably get spoiled with the company around me, you know. So he took me with him and I had to spend time in the operation theater. On the days when we were at home, you know, it was his favorite thing to ask me to sort of clean the scooter, clean the car, dismantle the carburetor, clean the carburetor, clean the spark plug, you know, and so on and so forth, you know. So I had to work very, very hard, you know, to be actually, it was important from his point of view that we earn a living and we earn the day, you know. So it was like his questioning to me as to what did you do today, you know, have you earned your bread today? Have you done enough to be able to have earned your bread, you know? So that was what really shaped me. My mother was very, very compassionate lady, and she taught me kindness. She taught me, you know, how to think, not for yourself, but how to think of other people, you know, because she was a living example. With limited means, she was always thinking of us and not of herself, you know. And that is why dedication to a greater cause, you know, to a cause which is bigger than you, I think was very, very important from the beginning.
But to be able to mold you so well in spite of your surroundings, it's truly incredible. Tell us a bit about your schooling and your extracurricular activities. Do you think they are necessary?
Yes, schooling, I did a normal schooling up to the 7th standard. And after that, I switched over to a technical school. I'll tell you the reasons why I switched over to a technical school. Where I learned engineering, you know, but schooling had a lot of impact also on me, you know, because I was a Boy Scout and I learned to be independent. I learned to go to camps. I learned to be away from the family. So that was all very, very important. One special aspect of my schooling, you know, and extracurricular activity which shaped me, very, very important aspect, I think, was music, you know, and I was learning music from a very young age, Indian classical music, and having done well in my exams, my teacher told me, you know, that I should undergo special training, I should undergo riyas. And actually, this story I have told even before, you know, this is very important from the point of view of sadhana or devotion, which is my second D. I tell you what, actually, with him, you know, so he said that if you Riyaz means practice, you know. So I'll come to your house and I will teach you, you know, but I will not come on my own. You have to come and fetch me, you know. So I may have been 10 or 11 at that time, you know, and which meant that I had to go to his house at about 3:30 in the morning. I had to wake him up. Having woken him up, he would get ready. We would leave his place around 4:30, come back to my house around 4:45, and do practice, and he would be there till about 7 with me, and then I would get ready and go to school, you know. Now, music created in me devotion, so devotion to something, you know. So it was devotion to music at that time, but then that devotion got transferred to other areas, like it has done to orthopedics and the importance of sadhana. Sadhana means actually dedicating yourself, you know, to be, you know, to be the best, to be able to sort of align your soul to whatever you are doing, you know, whether you are studying, whether you are playing music, whether you are dancing, whatever you do, you put your heart and soul in it, you know, and sadhana is practice also. So you have to practice as much, you know, so that you can become the best in the field, you know, and that is my second lesson I learned from school and because of music, and that was devotion. So the first was discipline, the second was devotion.
That's just amazing to be able to wake up so early in the morning and devote even to the practice of music. Just amazing. So I've often heard, you know, stories at home about you entering medicine against your father's wishes. Why did you want to become a doctor? Tell us a bit about it.
Okay, so the story of my becoming a doctor, you know, is like the story of many people wanting to become doctors. And the reason was that I was a sick child. I used to be a sort of a chronic asthmatic. I used to be down with asthma, and I remember my dad giving me injections, intravenous injections of aminophylline and deriphyline drips, deriphyline injection, aminophylline drips at home, sometimes putting oxygen cylinder. He was an anesthetist, so he was well versed with all this, you know, putting oxygen cylinders and nasal intubation or a mask for me, you know, and this all used to happen at home. Also, because of my illness, I came in contact with many doctors, pediatricians. I came in contact with them, you know, and because I was a sickly child, I developed admiration for these doctors. And I felt that they did so much, you know, to relieve you of your suffering. They did so much to better your quality of life. And they had so much of respect from the society, at least at that time they had, you know. And for that reason, I sort of decided that I want to become a doctor. Now, by the time actually you asked me about why I went to medical college against my dad's wishes, you know. So my dad actually took me to hospitals and took me around, you know, and showed me. I think he was very keen that I become a doctor. But then, you know, by the time I actually came up to the age when I could become a doctor, probably the field of medicine was undergoing a degradation, you know, and he felt that there's a lot of exploitation, degradation in the medical field. And for that reason, now I should not become a doctor. You know? So I had to fight with him because my mind was set on becoming a doctor. I had decided I want to be a doctor, and I stuck by it. I told him that if required, I'll raise the money to pay my own fees. You don't have to support me. And I will become a doctor. And I became a doctor.
Tell us a bit about your memories from the medical college days. You know, apart from academics, what else got your interest in?
Okay, so those days I was flying also, you know, so you've shown a picture of me flying. So I had a pilot's license, many other extracurricular activities, taking part in college. But my large interest was journalism and writing. So I was the editor for the college magazine and later on for the research journal of the medical college, of the Grand Medical College, you know. So to become an editor, you know, unfortunately, that job was called a magazine secretary's job, you know, and you had to fight an election, you know. And I'll tell you, you know, something secret which no one knows here in the family, you know, that I lost the first election, which I fought, you know. The reason was that I was thinking that, okay, merit is enough. I'm a good writer in English, and that's why people will vote for me. It did work that way. That taught me many hard realities of life, you know, that it's not only your sort of skill or your knowledge that is important, but how you get along with people. I think that is very, very important. How you project to the people, how you get onto their wavelength. I think that becomes very, very important. So that was a very important learning which I got when I was in medical college. Of course, we learned a lot from the medical college. Our batch was a superb batch. It is even now recognized as one of the best batches with so many talented people in the batch. You know, there are so many, some of whom are orthopedic surgeons like Anand, for example, Anand Joshi, you know. So there's so many people from this batch who have done so well in life, you know, and it was a very, very extremely talented batch. To survive in that batch with academics, with extra academics, extracurricular activities was quite a difficult task, yes.
I have also heard stories at home that from a very young age, you knew you wanted to be an orthopedic surgeon. How did that come to be, and how did you finally decide to pursue it?
Okay, so as I told you, I used to go with my dad to see surgeries, and I was always sort of fascinated by the glamour surrounding surgeons, you know, and surgeries, you know. So the surgeon was like a Lord of the Ring, you may call him. So like his word was final and everyone would listen to a surgeon. You know, so I used to watch surgeries and I decided, yes, I want to do medicine. So I want to do surgery. I want to be in the action field doing something, you know, not really like prescribing medicine, you know, not becoming a physician, you know. So that was decided that I'll be a surgeon, you know, and then when I watched surgeries, you know, I saw that orthopedic surgeries fascinated me, you know, internal fixation, putting plates, screws, all that, you know, because as a child, I played a lot with Meccano sets, you know. The only toys which my father gave me was Meccano sets. And I used to sort of mantle them, dismantle them, you know, all the time, you know, and this sort of appealed to me. I thought this is like doing mechano, you know. So it is doing mechano in a patient. You're doing a mechano in a human being. So this is great surgery, you know. So I wanted to become an orthopedic surgeon. Now, if I tell you something interesting, you know, what I did, you know, to become an orthopedic surgeon from a young age, you know. So I had already made up my mind that I'll be an orthopedic surgeon. And I switched school to go to a technical school, you know. So from the 8th standard, I joined the technical school near my house. And 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th, we had 11 standards then, you know. Those 4 years, you know, I studied engineering. I worked in the labs. I worked to do carpentry. I worked to do sort of lathe work, lathe machines, smithy, you know. So working with the hot ovens and hot iron, trying to mold them, you know, doing moldings, turning, fitting, every sort of thing, electrical engineering, doing wiring. So all that I did, you know, and I'll tell you beautifully what came out of it was that I learned a lot about alignment. I learned a lot about three dimensions, you know, because we had machine drawing where you are given one plane, another plane, and you make a third plane, you know. So your sort of mind becomes geared to thinking in three planes, you know, even though you may be given one plane, two planes, you know, generally two planes are required to get your third plane. But then you were able to do a 3D reconstruction very easily, you know, because you were trained in doing it. And I did machine drawing for 4 years, you know, and that gave me a real good sort of background of three dimensions to the extent that I really felt lost when I had to use a C-arm, you know. It's very recent that I started using C-arm, maybe the last about 8-10 years that I started using C-arm, you know, and I could manage complex surgeries without a C-arm. I'm not suggesting that you should not use a C-arm. You should always confirm, you should always be using a C-arm, but I'm just telling you how technical education helped shape me, you know, into an orthopedic surgeon. So that was sort of giving direction to your life. And here I come to the third D in my life, and that is direction. So I told you about discipline. I told you about devotion. And then with all this, you need to give a direction to your life. And that is the direction which I gave, the third D in my life.
I really didn't know about the machine drawing part. That's really amazing. So tell us about, you know, after entering residency, was orthopedics all that you hoped it might be? Because the hours are gruesome, the work is exhausting. Did you ever regret your decision to enter the field?
No, not at all, you know. On the contrary, I enjoyed it, you know, because during my internship, I worked very hard, 6 months in a civil hospital where the bosses would not come. I mean, they would have an evening party and they were sozzled. So, in fact, I had to do surgeries, you know. Even as an intern, of course, we did small surgeries, but a lot of surgery, a lot of practical things which we learned during the internship, and then staying day and night on call, doing venesections, catering to burn patients, catering to other CLWs and emergencies. For an intern, that was too much, you know. So when I shifted on to orthopedics, I had heard my seniors say, wow, what a field, don't take orthopedics, you know, it's too much of hard work. And those days, there were only sort of one registrar or two registrars for a unit, and the workload was terrible, you know. So all of them said, you know, no, don't take orthopedics, you know, do something else, you know. And I went into orthopedics and I really enjoyed it. I sort of never regretted my decision of coming to orthopedics because I could work that hard.
So any interesting stories from your residency you'd like to share with us?
Well, a lot of stories. Now, if I start telling you stories, I think the webinar will end there, you know. But maybe one or two stories I'll tell you. First is about my boss. Dr. Tarapurwala used to be my boss, and he was a very upright, a very great teacher, you know, and a very honest surgeon, you know. So he knew what his limitations were, and his first principle in life was do no harm. So that is what he taught us, you know, do no harm to the patient. Don't try adventurous surgeries. Now, it was famous about him. His punctuality was very, very famous, you know, and he would come for rounds at 7:30 in the morning. I mean, you could set your watch to it. 7:30 in the morning, his car would be there on the ground floor, you know, you could watch actually from the lobby that he is coming up, you know. And for his 7:30 rounds, I would remember, you know, what I used to do, you know. So I was the registrar in charge, which means I had to tell him about every patient. I don't know, we had 80, 90 patients, you know. So I had to tell him about every patient. So he would sometimes ask the blood report, sometimes ask some other reports, x-rays and things like that. So I remember going to the ward at about 4 in the morning, you know, or 3:30 in the morning at times, you know, to be able to go to every bed, set everything in order, you know, the number of x-rays, right from sequential x-rays, the most fresh one on the top, look at the blood reports, try to memorize them, at least make sure the blood reports were there, you know, whatever was missing, all that information was there, write the progress notes, you know, of the patient, make sure that each file was completed, you know, we had internal records, I had to make sure that each internal record was completed. And that was amazing learning, you know. So that was one of sort of experiences of residency which I will never forget. Of course, it was self-motivated. Other registrars may not have done the same, you know, but that gave me a tremendous idea, you know, of how to do things, you know, and what is required, you know. So what is required when you become a boss, what you expect from the people under you, you know, from your subordinates, what do you expect, you know? And sort of, if I was able to fulfill the expectations of my teacher, I expect that other people, my subordinates, my students should be able to fulfill my expectations. You know? So that was one experience. If you want to hear more, I have lots and lots of experiences I can give you. You know, I don't know if you have time, but I can tell you, you know. Okay, I'll relate to you one very, very small experience, you know. So it was the first day of my registrarship, you know, and... two new housemen came to the unit, you know. So I told them, okay, like, you know, we have to start the next day. So I gave them a message the previous evening that you two are joining and please meet me at 8 o'clock in the ward and we're going to do a round to sort of come to know what is happening to each of those patients, you know. And we started the round at 8 o'clock. I went bed by bed and 80, 90 patients, you know, whatever the numbers, you know. It was 3 o'clock by the time the round ended, you know. So we started at 8, finished at 3 o'clock. And whether you believe it or not, you know, the next day, one of the housemen didn't turn, you know, and he was actually senior to me in age, you know, and he never turned up, you know, and I thought maybe something is wrong with him. He'll come the day after, you know. He never came the day after. And 15 days went by. He never came, you know. So I got worried and I went to the office and told them to find out what is the matter with him. You know, I know his name. I won't reveal that, you know. He had left orthopedics. He said, no, I don't want to take a branch, you know, which is sort of so taxing, you know. He shifted, in fact, from medicine to business, you know. So he went off to business. And that was a great experience I had on day one of my registrarship.
Probably working under you is not for the
faint-hearted. No, not that way. But like, you know, I think he had probably never worked like that in his life. It was, I don't know whether he was actually... I mean, in the sense that whether he was like registered for MS Orth or whether he was just doing a house post as an allied thing, you know, I'm not sure, you know, but he never turned up again. So I didn't know him that well.
Okay, let's shift gears to another interesting area of your life. You had an early marriage. So did you meet your now wife then during residency? Tell us a bit about your courtship. How did that aspect of your life
happen? Yeah, that is all secret, you know, not to be given. But anyway, sort of we met during our internship. I think she just finished her final MBBS and the examination, the final professional exam. And I was about to finish my internship and we met. And sort of... we liked each other, so we carried on, and that went on for 4 years, you know, because I had to complete my residency, you know, so from internship to my residency to about her completing her residency, you know, so 4 years of courtship, pretty long, you know, but I wouldn't say a very romantic courtship, you know, the reasons were very, very obvious, you know, very, very busy life as an orthopedic guy, as an orthopedic registrar, and she used to come to Bombay, she was from Bangalore. She was doing ophthalmology in Bangalore and she had to, whenever she had time, she would visit Bombay and I would say that, okay, I'm coming, you know, just hold on, I'm coming, and I would be gone for 4 or 5 hours. I wouldn't be seen, you know, go to the wards and get involved with something, you know, and that is how it went along, you know, in the early days.
Okay, so life after residency, tell us a bit about that. How did you enter the field of children's orthopedics? Was it even a branch back then?
Well, no. It actually happened during my residency itself, you know. So I had six months time. We did two house posts. The third post, I had to wait to get a registrar post because it used to fall vacant once in 2 years, you know. So there was 6 months of time. And during that time, I was interested in pediatric orthopedics because I was always sort of in love with children. I always was playing with them, you know, and I always thought that let's sort of explore this, you know. So I went to the Children's Orthopedic Hospital at Haji Ali in Mumbai, you know, and Dr. Mulla Firoz was the boss, you know, and she was a gigantic lady, gigantic in the sense that very tall and imposing personality, a lieutenant colonel in the British Army. She had Order of the British Empire. She fought World War II in the Middle East, in Burma and United India, which is Afghanistan, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. So she was a terrific lady, you know, and she was also the head of department earlier at JJ. She left JJ to shift to Children's Orthopedic Hospital full-time to do children's orthopedics, you know. This was the institution developed for poliomyelitis because of the polio epidemic there. I went to that hospital to learn pediatric orthopedics to get an exposure. I got a wonderful exposure of pediatric orthopedics, not only from her, from the other consultants who were there, you know. And polio at that time really appealed to me because it was based on biomechanics. So what do you do for a flail joint? For example, you fuse the joint, you know, you try to get the alignment of the extremity. That was important. How do you make a guy sit, you know, if his spine is collapsing, you fuse the spine. You know, so this was sort of biomechanically principled, and I thought this is great, you know. This is something to my liking. It is orthopedics, it is engineering combined together. And that's why I took a liking to pediatric orthopedics. But that was during residency. And then I did my 2 years of registrarship. Then I came over to Sion Hospital as a tutor and then as a lecturer, you know. And actually, that's a big story of how I was able to get a direction there, you know. But let me tell you that when I joined Sion Hospital, well, the first 2 years I was doing everything, doing all of general orthopedics, doing trauma, doing, actually, very curiously, I was doing a lot of arthroscopies at that time, you know, because I discovered the arthroscope in the hospital, in the sister's cupboard. So I started using it. Somebody had ordered it and retired, so they had forgotten. I started using it and also developed pediatric orthopedics, you know. But it's a much later story, you know, what happened, how I went into full-time pediatric orthopedics, you know, because if I were to tell you, I went off then to Japan to train, I came back, you know, and I think I will tell you the story as we go on.
You have trained us in Japan, UK, Latvia, France, USA. How did those opportunities come about and how was the experience? Tell us a bit about.
Well, my first sort of exposure outside India was in Japan, you know, and those days it was very difficult to go abroad, you know. Fellowships were unheard of, you know, we really didn't know what is a fellowship, you know. I really didn't know what was a fellowship, you know, and getting an opportunity to go and spend time somewhere was unheard of, you know, and it was a lucky stroke, you know. That year, the year prior to my going to Japan, you know, because of connections between the president of the Indian Orthopaedic Association, Professor Marwa, and I'm grateful to him, very grateful to him, because he had a connection with Japan, with the Children's Center in Japan, you know. The Children's Center in Japan offered a fellowship, and Professor Marwa advertised it to the Indian Orthopaedic Association. There were a lot of applications. Somehow I got selected. I was not knowing him. He was based in Nagpur. He was the dean, head of Department of Orthopaedics at Nagpur. I got selected. So he called me up and he said, congratulations, you are selected. You have to go to Japan. This was 9 months before I actually went to Japan. And then he said that one important thing for you is that you have to know how to talk Japanese, you know, because in Japan, very few people speak English. This was in the 80s, 84, 85, you know. So you have to learn Japanese, you know, to be able to survive there. You know? So I said, that's fine, sir, no problem. So I actually learned Japanese. And when I went to Japan, I again did an intensive training in Japanese, intensive course in Japanese, 2 months course in Japanese. And that allowed me serviceable Japanese to be able to communicate with the people there. I did that fellowship and I came back from that fellowship. This was end of 1985. So when I came back, you know, I wanted to do pediatric orthopedics, you know, and at that time at Sion Hospital, Lokmanya Tilak Medical College, Dr. Lad was the head of the department. So I spoke to him, sir, I want to develop pediatric orthopedics. And he was most encouraging, you know, and I owe a great debt to him. The reason was that he told me, okay, I'm going to give you a side room. It has 6 beds, small beds in the side room. It's a pediatric thing. You know, you take that whole pediatric thing for your unit, you know, you create a pediatric orthopedic unit and you do a pediatric orthopedic OPD, you know. So that's how we started doing pediatric orthopedic OPD, and a pediatric orthopedic ward was established. And that formed the beginnings actually of pediatric orthopedics in a teaching setup, you know. So prior to that, there was no pediatric orthopedic unit in a teaching setup. So this was the first unit in the country we started, thanks to the foresight of Dr. Lad, I must say, you know. So that was the first part of my foray outside India. And then I came back and I started doing pediatric orthopedics, you know.
So you seem to have spent a lot many years in training before starting practice. You feel that's necessary? Tell us a bit, because we have a lot of young viewers who would like to know about that.
Okay, so it's a rather long story again. You know, so I came back to India and I started this pediatric orthopedic unit, and then I was selected in the meantime to Wardia Children's Hospital to do, because they had a children's orthopedic setup in Wardia, you know, but the person there was retiring and it was at a low ebb at that time, you know. So they wanted someone who could shore up, you know, the hospital's department, you know. And Dr. Dalal, who was the dean, you know, he was very keen that I join, you know. And he sort of, after the interview, told me that you have to join, you know, you have to come here and you have to work here, you know. So I decided to leave Sion Hospital then, you know. This was about a year and a half or so after establishing the pediatric orthopedic OPD and unit. I left, I went to Wardia Children's Hospital. I was already at Children's Orthopedic Hospital at Haji Ali. But then an opportunity came by and I sort of got a opportunity to go to England and do the MCH Orth, you know. And luckily for me, it's a long story again, I really don't want to go into it. I got a chance to do the MCH Orth from India. I went to England. I was given the most coveted job at that time, the registrar post at Alderhay Children's Hospital, which was something unusual for somebody who never trained in England, you know. So they would never give a registrar job directly. They sort of felt that confidence in me and they gave it to me. So I worked in England for 1 year. That was the whole of 1988. And I came back to India, you know. And in the intervals after coming back, I kept going abroad again and again. So I went to France to work under Dubuisson. This was a fellowship which I wrote to him, you know, that I want to be trained by you. You know, I want to work in this field. I want to learn about the CD instrumentation. So he invited me to come to his place in 1994. I spent 1 month there with him. I went to Latvia to study the circular external fixator. They also sort of hosted me and gave me a place to stay, gave me a stipend. The same thing with Dubuisson, gave me a place to stay, you know, so I could stay. So that expense was not there. So we did these number of fellowships, you know, to get trained in different aspects. Now you asked me a question about the long training period, you know. So I spent 8 years after my MS orthopedics training, you know, in different parts of the world, training in India. So I had a very, very well-rounded experience, you know. To be honest, if I tell you, even in my adult orthopedic practice, you know, I had virtually done everything what was possible at that time, you know, and then the whole of pediatric orthopedics, you know. So naturally, it would take a long time to sort of get trained well, you know, and I believe that is very, very important, you know. So spending time in trainings, I spent 8 years before I started practice. Not that we were very rich so that I could afford to sort of postpone my practice. No, it was not that, you know, but it was the fact that I wanted to be well-trained, you know, to be able to tackle anything. When I come back to India, when I settle in my practice, you know, I should be capable of doing everything that I wanted to do in my field, you know, and that was the sort of motive behind training for so long. I trained 8 years. I would recommend training for everyone, you know. May not be 8 years, maybe 4 years, maybe 3 years, but one needs to train, train and train, work, work and work, you know, to be able to develop that confidence to develop the specialty, you know. one of the reasons why this specialty got developed was because I was at that level, you know, where I could do a lot independently. I think that's important to keep in mind.
So then, after your return to India, how did you go about building your pediatric orthopedic practice? Were you the first specialized surgeon, so to say, or were there others before you?
Okay, so when I came back to India, I wanted to practice pediatric orthopedics, but I was trying to sort of get used to the climate after I came back from England, and I talked to a lot of my senior people, I talked to a lot of my teachers, telling them that I wanted to practice exclusive pediatric orthopedics. And then they told me, you are stupid. You know, if you want to practice pediatric orthopedics, what is it that pediatric orthopedic people do, you know? The club foot. So we also do club foot. So what's there in the club foot? Who's going to refer you any club foot, you know? Who's going to refer you anything else in pediatrics, you know? We're all doing the same, you know? There are a lot of general orthopedic surgeons who were doing pediatric orthopedics. In a huge proportion, you know, of their practice, they were doing, you know. So many people dissuaded me from doing pediatric orthopedics. But I was sort of firm. I said, let's see how it goes. So my requirements are very, very minimum. And if I can make a living just enough to get by, you know, I'm fine, you know. I will stick to this, you know. But having said that, you know, even then, in the first years, I had to do general orthopedics along with pediatric orthopedics. And then I started sort of focusing exclusively on pediatric orthopedics, you know, saying that I will not accept adult patients. I had a big clientele of adult patients by then, you know, and their phones continued sometimes for 10 and 15 years afterwards. Doctor, you were actually seeing us. Now, what is the matter? You know, why have you not seen us? Or their children will sometimes phone, you know, dad wants to see you or we want to see you. You know? But I said, no, I'm not. I'm doing only pediatric orthopedic practice. And in that sense, yes, I was the first person to practice, especially in private, exclusive pediatric orthopedics. So way back 91, actually, to be precise, we started doing only pediatric orthopedics. You know. And this brings me to my fourth D. You know, I told you three Ds, if you remember. So discipline, devotion, direction, and the fourth D is determination. That determination has been a very, very important part. I was determined to go to medical college. I was determined to do pediatric orthopedics, practice pediatric orthopedics, develop that specialty. I think that has been a very, very important part in whatever you may call it, whether you call it success or whatever you call it. For me, yes, it's success in a way because I set out to do something and I did it. I accomplished that. You know, so that's what, that is the fourth important lesson. You know? Fourth D.
Coming to the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India, tell us a bit about how it all began.
Okay, so when I came back from England, but this story actually goes to even before that time, you know. There are very few people who were presenting at conferences on pediatric orthopedics, you know. So notably, Dr. Benjamin Joseph, who's a big name now, Mr. Perthes himself, as I call him, you know, and I used to present on different aspects of pediatric orthopedics at different conferences. We used to meet, you know, and we came to know each other even then, way back from 82, where the first conference where I met him, he met me, was in 1982, and we kept meeting each other. I took up his job actually in England. He was registrar at Alderhay, and he left to come back to India. And I took his job, you know, so we had an interaction even at that time, you know, but nothing much happened. We said, yes, we must develop pediatric orthopedics in India, but nothing much happened, you know. So later on, you know, once in India and once we were presenting at conferences, we got together and thought we should have a pediatric orthopedic society. It is the need of the day. Pediatric forms a huge volume. It's about 40% of the cases of orthopedics totally is pediatric orthopedics. And so we need a society, you know, wherein we can actually discuss these matters. We can get training opportunities for younger people. We can invite people to speak, you know, and that's how the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India came about, you know. 1994 April, I organized the inaugural meeting of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. Now, you have to remember that 1994 was a different era altogether. We were in awe of our teachers, you know, the teachers were there. And we were young people who were there, you know, there was such a big difference, such a big gap, you know, between everything. and no one dared speak to teacher, to your teacher, except as sir, you know, and very, very respectfully, very politely, you know. And we were worried, you know, that being youngsters, we are starting off with the society, and I mean, we are going to hear a lot from all the senior people, you know, because how dare you sort of start a society, you know, how dare you think of getting away from the main orthopedic body, you know. But to my surprise, you know, when I arranged this meeting, I had the president of the Indian Orthopedic Association come, Prasad, Arul Mittal, actually of Patiala was the president, Dr. Taneja was there, Professor Mukhopadhyay, who was past president, and he'd been the founder secretary of the Indian Orthopedic Association, he was there. Dr. Dholakke, of course, was there. This meeting was at Bombay Hospital. Dr. Mila Firoz was there. And we had our bosses, you know, Verghese Chacko, Professor Verghese Chacko, who later became a president of the Indian Orthopedic Association. Dr. Tarapurwala, my mentor, he became a president of the Indian Orthopedic Association. Dr. Sriram, K. Sriram from Chennai, who was doing a lot of pediatric work. All of us actually were there, you know, and that gave a fillip to the pediatric orthopedic movement. And that's how the Pediatric Orthopedic Society came to be established. I wrote to a lot of members of the Indian Orthopedic Association saying that we are creating such a body, and I received outstanding support from everyone. At least about 150 to 200 people wrote back to me saying, very good, go ahead and create the body. And they became members, you know. So we had, I think, about 200 members very, very fast. In the first one or two years, we had 200 members. You know, because, I mean, people becoming orthopedic surgeons, becoming members of the Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. From then on, you know, Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India meetings started. The first one was in Manipal in 1995, organized by Benjamin Joseph, and then by other sort of dignitaries like Professor Sriram organized the meeting in Chennai. The Pediatric Orthopedic Society took off, very good academics, a lot of foreign faculty coming to our meetings. And now with the climate of research, those research papers are equivalent to the best anywhere internationally. You know, the Pediatric Orthopedic Society really did very well, and it celebrated its 25th year. Just last year, 2019, we had a 25th of the Silver Jubilee.
It's a very vibrant and very highly academic, esteemed body today.
Yeah, it's purely academic, because the way the criteria have been laid out, you know, no one can become office bearer, you know, unless you are academic, you know. So you have to have 3 publications, or you should have worked extensively in pediatric orthopedics, or a pediatric orthopedic fellowship you would have done, you know. So those sort of criteria being there, only serious people can get into the sort of office bearer category to take that organization forward. In fact, I'm very, very proud of the fact that Pediatric Orthopedic Society will soon be the world's largest pediatric orthopedic body. You know, we sort of are behind the POSNA, no doubt, you know. But with our sort of expansion rate, the rate at which the Indian population is growing, the rate at which there is a demand for pediatric orthopedics, you know, it's on the rise. Whereas in the US, in the other countries, because the fertility rates are low, you know, the demand for pediatric orthopedics actually coming down. So I'm sure that another 4 or 5 years would be the world's largest body in pediatric orthopedics.
That's just incredible, sir. Tell us a bit now about your contributions and innovations to Indian orthopedics.
Okay, so there are so many, you know, so I'll try to cut short because I see that we are running out of time, you know. So I'll tell you some things, you know. So 1987, I was working on sequelae of septic arthritis of the hip, and that time I didn't know of any classification. So I devised my own classification. This classification won many laurels. It won the Best Treatise Award of the Bombay Orthopedic Society. 1989, when I came back from England, you know, I started practice. We developed the indigenous telescoping nail. I developed a system for anterior fixation of scoliosis, and that's a totally entirely different story, how I got interested in scoliosis, because hardly anyone was doing scoliosis at that time. So we developed a device for anterior fixation for vertebral bodies, and I developed a uniplanar fixator, which allowed fragment transportation, which allowed vertical transport, it allowed horizontal transport, it allowed angular corrections, it allowed adjustments to the sort of different things which you find difficult with the uniplanar fixator, you know. This uniplanar fixator actually won the AMF gold medal in 1993 at the Indian Orthopedic Association. I was doing a lot of anterior spine surgeries for spinal deformities. 1991, we won the Dr. A.K. Talwalkar Award, you know, of the Bombay Orthopedic Society for this. Then we did a lot of research on gliding movement of the neck, you know, which was unknown. But you see that in a dancer, they sort of swing from side to side, you know, I can't do it too well, you know, and we studied that movement. We did CT scans, we did EMGs, we did a lot, you know. That work, unfortunately, is still not published, you know, but that won the Silver Jubilee Oration Award at that time. You know. Then in spine surgeries, we did a lot, you know, multi-segmental fixation. I introduced that 1994 in the country. We were using Harrington rods prior to that. Then endoscopic spine surgery. 96, 97, I started with endoscopic spine surgery, culminated in 1998 into the first Congress, National Congress of Endoscopic Spine Surgery. Then Vector, for example, magnetic rods, magnetic lengthening of the extremities. Of course, we were not the first to use MAGEC, which is magnetic expansion for the spine, but we have a use series of that, you know, so that was done. Then botulinum toxin, for example, I introduced it on a large scale in orthopedics, you know, I was the first one to introduce that in 1998. So a lot of innovations and a lot of introductions to Indian orthopedics, you know. Besides that, of course, orations, workshops internationally, we've done a lot. I've been faculty on the burn orthopedic course, burn hip course, actually. Then we did workshops on botulinum toxin virtually in the whole of Asia. We've done other workshops elsewhere, neighboring countries. Of course, we have been doing lots of workshops, you know, and orations, lectures, books. I'm just finishing the sixth, editing the sixth book. You know, it's on the pediatric foot, and that will be out very soon from Springer. So books, papers, publications, so lots of contributions.
So apart from your huge academic contributions, you've been the president of numerous national, international orthopedic bodies. So do you feel these are really important contributions? How important are they in making you a legend?
Well, I don't personally attribute... But I don't know if I'm a legend still, you know, but I don't attribute this presidentship to anything. I mean, there have been so many presidents of the Indian Orthopedic Association who have come and gone. There have been so many international presidents who have come and gone. So people don't really, just because you're a president, people don't remember you. You know? It's not because of that. It is because they remember you because of your contributions to the science, contribution to academic, contribution to the society, you know. And all that makes you a legend, you know. So I don't think it's very important for anyone to be a president of a society, except that it gives you a very broad view. It gives you an idea of how people think, you know, how people would do things, you know. We learn from each other, you know, and it broadens your horizons, and it gives you a chance to actually influence some change, at least, in the way orthopedics is practiced or in the way we think about orthopedics nationally, internationally.
So you've been the editor of Journal of Pediatric Orthopedics B, and it is a time-consuming job. I've often seen you come back home, you know, long after midnight, after long operative pediatric reconstructions, and sit straight on your laptop to finish your academic commitments. How important is academic success in making you a legend?
I think it is important. Again, academics also has a role, but... just because you are an academician, you don't become a legend unless your contribution is so great, you know, that people talk about it. Like, for example, maybe like Ponseti method in clubfoot, you know. So the contribution is so great, or Salter's contribution, the Salter's osteotomy is so great, you know, that people talk about and remember him because of that. He's a legend because of that. Just by writing many papers and publications, you don't become a legend, you know. So academic contributions are important, I think. But they have to be taken in the correct perspective. You know? So I think that perspective is important. You can write a lot, but if you can write a lot of rubbish, and that also goes through, you know, being an editor, I know, you know, sometimes there's so much use of statistics. Sometimes there's so much there, you know, it becomes difficult to differentiate, you know, between the actual sort of something worthwhile and worthless sort of publication, you know, so that is one part of academics, you know, but being an editor of the Journal of Pediatric Orthopedics gives you an international acclaim, you know, people all over know you, you know, and you're capable of doing that job, and that is why you've been given that job, you know, so it is a sort of testimonial for you, you know, that you're capable of doing that job. It's not an easy job. Taking decisions on papers when somebody writes reject, somebody writes accept, you know, and you need to decide which are the landmark papers, which are going to contribute, which are going to be cited in the future. So that's a very, very responsible job, I feel. It's one of the most responsible jobs, as good as doing surgery. And it's very time consuming. You know, I spend on average about 14 hours a week doing my editorial job. So, but it gives me international recognition. It gives me an insight into research which is happening in which part of the world, you know, who's thinking what much in advance of the publication.
Now, having worked with you, sir, for many years, I can vouch for the fact that if you're even a little unsatisfied with the outcome of surgery, you have no regrets absolutely in restarting the case irrespective of the time pressures. Was the perfectionism and meticulousness a part of who you were, or what they developed as habits?
Okay, so yes, in a way, yes. As I said, in my early parts, I was disciplined, and even how to write on a piece of paper, how much of a margin should be left. I think my dad taught me that, okay, you leave a 1-inch margin from top, from the side, you know. So that meticulousness was always there, but it got exemplified when I came to surgery, you know. Because I realized that if I did a less than first-class job, you know, the patient came back with complications, and that was so distressing. You know? Distressing to the patient, distressing to the family, and distressing to me, you know, because if I had to reoperate that patient afterwards, you know, it meant expense, it means so much of social hardships, psychological problems, and, you know, even for me as a doctor, my conscience was not clear, you know. So I decided that my conscience should always be clear, and I should do a job which is the best I'm capable of doing. I don't say that, okay, that's the best possible, you know, but within my limitations, if I'm able to do that sort of a job, you know, which is necessary to be done for the patient, you know, I'll always do that. It doesn't matter whatever time of the day or night it is. I don't look at the clock for that matter, you know. It doesn't matter if the next case is waiting, we postpone it, but I have to be satisfied with the surgery I have done to be able to go ahead. And this is largely so in practice, yes.
An operating room is like a battlefield. There are lots of unexpected twists, turns, uncertainties. How do you keep your calm in tough situations?
Okay. So how does one keep calm, you know, in these sort of situations? So I told you very beginning, you know, sort of my having sort of grown in a deprived background, you know, in like area like a slum, you know. So one has always to be cool. You have to keep your wits about you. And I developed a very fatalistic attitude that, I mean, whatever I can control, I can control. Whatever I cannot control, I don't worry about it. I mean, what can I do about it? I'm a human being after all, you know. So I think that attitude has always served me very well, you know. So that is a fatalistic attitude. I have kept my cool, you know, at all times. I have kept my cool. I have focused on that moment, you know. So that is a very, very important point I want to tell you. Don't focus on the repercussions of what will happen later on, you know. Oh, what will I tell? What is happening to the patient? What will I tell? And what? No. What is required at that time, at that minute? You do that. You'll be involved, totally focus on that, and you will have no problems keeping cool.
Sometimes surgical outcomes are unsatisfactory in spite of best of our efforts, and handling patients and their families is a tall task. Any insights for our young viewers on the same?
Well, I think one has to use tact, do things very tactfully. One has always to give hope to the patient. One has to be frank, but in a tactful way. One has to tell the patient the truth. I don't say that you hide the truth. You tell the truth, but in a very tactful manner. Most often than not, you know, they would still get a result. You know, maybe it's not the best you could give them, you know, in spite of all your efforts, but they would probably be better off than where they started, you know. And for that reason, I think it's important to be very hopeful. Give them hope, give them courage, you know. So give them solace. I think that is important. That is the human side of medicine, which I think is also very, very important.
Okay, sir, how do you see the future of pediatric orthopedics shaping up in India?
Well, we were dealing with neglected problems all along. You know, most of my practice used to be neglected problems. I think as a society, we now need to take up problems, detect them early, do prevention, do surveillance. And in fact, one of the projects we have started already is hip surveillance for cerebral palsy. you know, so we hope to catch people in time, you know, get people in time to be able to do lesser surgeries with better results, better outcomes, proactive management with better outcomes. So I think the field will gradually shift like it has happened in the developing countries. For example, in Japan, I never saw a neglected DDH. I never operated on one. In other countries, for example, you don't have to do heroic surgeries on spinal deformities, which are over 100 degrees, you know. So we catch them early, we treat them early. So I think that's very one important aspect of the future of pediatric orthopedics. But as I see it, the future is very, very bright, you know, because of number of reasons, you know. Now we are in a developed state of pediatric orthopedics. Even the allied branches have developed very well in the last two decades or three decades, you know. Pediatric anesthesia, for example, has developed so well, you know. And we are working now on epidurals. We are working on regionals, ultrasound guided regionals. A lot of it was developed in my setup here, you know, and my anesthetists have been pioneer in this field, you know, of pediatric anesthesia. So that's come about, you know, very well, along with pediatric orthopedics, pediatric prosthetics, orthotics, rehabilitation, all that is excellent now, you know, getting better day by day. It is getting better. So we are on a better wicket, you know, the future is very good. It's going to require more and more people in the times to come. And I see it as a very bright field, a very good field for the newcomer, because you have also specialization in pediatric orthopedics, like pediatric trauma, for example, or for that matter, pediatric sports medicine, or pediatric spine, you know, pediatric hand and upper extremity. All these are going to develop in times to come. You know, it's just a matter of few years, you know, that we'll find these developments take place and people pioneering these branches, you know. And this is going to happen. It is just a matter of time. So the future, I would say, is very, very good and very bright, you know, for pediatric orthopedics.
It's an audience question now.
Yeah, sure.
I want to know what has been your inspiration? Do you have any regrets in life?
Well, inspiration, yes, of course, the great people always inspire you. But I have learned to get inspired not only by the great people, but by everything, everybody around you, you know. So even watching a child sort of focus with rapt attention to the game, you know, inspires me. Somebody cleaning the street so well, you know. Occasionally I halt on the road if I'm walking and I see people, you know, how they're doing it, you know, and doing it so meticulously and so well. And no one is looking, you know, why is that man doing it this way? You know, he's hardly getting any money for it. He's hardly being paid for it. So that's a source of inspiration, you know. So there's so much of inspiration all around you if you just care to look, you know. If you're grateful, if you have that feeling of gratefulness, gratitude, I think inspiration is all around you. So I think inspiration is not difficult to find. The next question was of regrets, you know. Well, regret for a medical man, very few, you know, because he has chosen that field, you know. He has chosen that field. He has chosen to give of himself for society. He has chosen to give himself for his patients. Well, maybe people don't agree with this philosophy now, I know, you know. But then the era is of group practice, you know. It wasn't there in the past, you know. So we had to sacrifice so many things, right from sacrificing our own self, you know, because you were giving so much of yourself, you know, to your patients, you know, sacrificing your own self, sacrificing your family life, sacrificing your time, sacrificing your social life, you know. For example, I have lost all my friends, you know, because I really can't keep up with social life, you know. So all that is there, but the joys of medicine, I don't regret, you know. I mean, I wouldn't change my career, you know. If I were given a second chance, I would still go for medicine because it's such a beautiful amalgam, you know. You have science on one hand, you have humanities on the other hand, being human, being creative, being articulate, being able to express, being able to write, being able to speak, lecture, being able to research. I don't know of any other field which can give you so much, you know, so much of satisfaction. We all start life at a different level, you know. We must not regret that, you know. So there is an inherent, inbuilt sort of, let me say, a sort of advantage or disadvantage when you compare two people, you know, but that should not bother you as long as you're doing the best you are doing and you're enjoying your life and there's no one else really going to question you, you know. I mean, except maybe your family members, you know, but if you are enjoying life, you're passionate about it and you're doing the best you can, Why should you have regrets? Yes, time has been a regret. I admit that for a number of reasons. I do admit that, you know, but there's that much only that a medical man can do, you know. He can either be with his patients, with his books, research, publications, you know, or he can be with his family and he can socialize, you know. So one, I think medical man has to define, you know, how best he can get that balance.
So another audience question, what according to the legend is a mantra for success?
Well, mantra for success is not very difficult to find. There's only one mantra for success. Osler said it long ago, you know. If you have read the book Equanimitas by Osler, you know, and he talks about the master word in medicine. There's only one master word in medicine, and that is work. Work, work, and work. Hard work, you know. So I have believed in that mantra because, I mean, you mentioned that I have been on my own orbit, you know. And if I have been on my own orbit and still I have to achieve so much, you know, I have to work hard. There is no way I can do it without working hard. So if I have to have patient satisfaction, clinical satisfaction, research satisfaction, academic satisfaction, social in the orthopedic circle, associations and other things, you know, all that satisfaction I have to have, I have no option but to work hard. So I have always believed in this, you know, that hard work is the mantra. It's very simple, you know. People know the mantra, but people usually may follow or may not follow it. But in medicine, I think it's very, very applicable that the mantra is hard work. People talk about smart work, you know, and it's my innate belief, you know, that whatever I have achieved is through hard work. I never use smart work, you know. Yes, if you let go of opportunities, you are foolish. You should not let go of opportunities, you know, to that extent you have to be smart. But people take shortcuts and do what is called popularly nowadays a smart work, you know. I don't believe in that, you know. I have always worked hard and I have always been satisfied with what I have done. My conscience is clear and, you know, I have enjoyed all the things that I have done.
So, having dissected a legend, what is the take-home message? How can ordinary mortals become legends?
So, you want a formula for becoming a legend, is it? Well, I have no formulas, you know, for becoming a legend. I told you about the lessons I learned in life, you know, and the lessons I learned, I sort of stressed those, you know. The first and foremost were discipline. I tell you that discipline is the most important sort of ingredient. It's very difficult to lead a disciplined life. And you see people retire, you know, musicians. I mean, they have years, day in, day out, they're practicing, you know. A good surgeon has to keep doing surgeries. And at one stage, you reach an end point, you know, where you feel, how much more have I to do? You know? So you see these tennis players retiring, you know. But you keep your enthusiasm, you keep your discipline, you keep it going. I think that's the very, very first lesson. You know? The second lesson is devotion, dedication. So you devote yourself. You know, you want to do orthopedics, right? So why not devote yourself to orthopedics and be happy about it, you know, rather than crib that I'm not able to do this, I'm not able to do that. The situation is not right, you know. I mean, you take life in your own hands and you shape it the way you want, you know. So devotion, I think, to the field becomes very, very important. I'm not saying only for orthopedics. You could be devoted to two fields, you know. You may have an extracurricular passion, you know. You may have a hobby where also you can excel, you know. So a lot of doctors have been good writers, you know. A lot of surgeons have been, you know, very good with their extracurricular work. They have been having different sort of hobbies and doing different things, you know. So that's the second D, you know. The third D, of course, is that you have a sense of direction, you know. Where are you going? Periodically ask yourself, you know, where are you going? I even now ask myself, where am I meant to go, you know. So having done all this, what more should I be doing, you know. So you sort of reassess yourself. You go forwards and then you come a step back. You try to understand what you've been doing, why you have been doing. That direction is very, very important. What direction is required for your future? I think that is important, you know. So what do you plan? I mean, it's a general sense of direction. I'm not saying that you plan to be president of India, you know. So you set your sight on doing whatever you can to be president of India. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying the direction, you know. Which way you are moving, I think you have to understand that and you have to shape a direction. And of course, the last important ingredient is determination. You're determined to do something. In other words, you say you're perseverant. You're perseverant to do something that is important. So with all these 4 Ds, with something of you to give, you know, to society, to science, to knowledge, when you have all these 4 and you have output which you can give, you know, which people want, nothing can prevent you from becoming a legion. The formula is very, very simple, isn't it? Well, you just have to follow the 4 Ds in life. I think if I would like to end, I don't know if we are ending, the more questions, you know, but if, because we are over time. But if I have to sort of give my last message, you know, it is that follow these 4 Ds. Lead a life which is disciplined in some ways, you know. Devote yourself. Of course, you're devoted, but sort of rededicate yourself, you know. Redefine your direction, you know, which is the direction you want to move. And then finally, once you've decided all this, you know, you're determined to achieve whatever you set out to achieve. I think that is important. And it should have a meaning. It should have a meaning, end of the day. So you're doing it not only for yourself, but you're doing it for others. You have to give. You know. To be a legion, you have to give. You just can't receive and say, I'm a legion. You don't take from everyone. I'm a legion. No, it doesn't happen that way. You have to give. Every time you have to give. You know. So that is important. Give of your time. Give of your energies, you know. Sometimes you wonder, why are you devoting so much time to so many things, you know, which are useless. In many people's point of view, it is useless, you know. Why are you sort of devoting? Why are you, for example, after finishing a long day, you know, why have you come home and you opened your books and you're preparing for the case next morning, you know? Can't you go to bed now, you know? It's time to go to bed. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. No. You have to be ready, you know, for whatever you're doing next day, you know. So that is determination, your discipline and determination. I got to read, I got to look up the anatomy, or I got to look up a journal, find out, you know, whether what I'm thinking is the right way of going. Doesn't matter, whatever is the time. So you should be able to, I mean, time is something which is on a different absolute, you know. And I live in my own world, in my own orbit, which is a different orbit. Of course, we have to respect time. Everyone respects time, you know, but time has limited meaning when you are in your own orbit. I hope I've explained things.
Sir, an hour falls short to summarize your decorated life. Your unique journey has been documented beautifully in IJPO, the Indian Journal of Pediatric Orthopedics, by Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan and Dr. Ashok Shyam. I would urge our viewers to really read that up. It's a must read. Concluding the same, I wish to thank Alchem for giving this opportunity. I truly take back a lot of teaching today, and I'm sure many of our viewers do. Do watch out for the next Legend in Medicine series, which is on the 10th of May. The iconic Dr. D.D. Tanna is going to be interviewed by Dr. Amit Asgaonkar and Dr. Sangeet Gawale. That should be a very exciting one to watch. So goodbye, one and all, and have a great day.
I wish to thank Alchem for this series, and also I wish to thank all our viewers, you know, who have been watching intently. Thank you.